In the making of a film, the control of the lighting, the balance of the colors, and the composition of the image is the work of the director of photography, or cinematographer. Vittorio Storaro is one of the world's most creative and influential cinematographers. Since 1968, he has photographed over 30 feature films all over the world.
Vieni su man mano tu, Enrico. Continua Mauro, continua Mauro. Alza 10.000, Enrico.
Storaro is not only a great cinematographer, but he's a man of ideas, and he has really uplifted our profession by his theories, in which he considers, and I think he's right, that we contribute to the writing of the film. I mean, his images are not only beautiful or professional, they actually tell the story.
Seguo da tutta una vita, un po' come la luna fa nel cielo. Lo rincorre dal mattino alla sera, fino a questo momento di incredibile equilibrio tra il tramontare del sole e il nascere della luna, tra questi due punti dello spettro cromatico che sono un po' tutta la mia vita. La passione del rosso, il raziocinio del blu. È tutta una vita che li inseguo, ogni volta per tentare di fotografare, di scrivere con questo sole, con quella luna, con quell'ombra, con quella luce, una storia. E una storia, essendo il cinema un linguaggio di immagini, e essendo un'immagine formata dalla luce e dalla sua assenza che è l'ombra, e da tutti quelli che sono i componenti interni a se stessa che sono i colori, va comunque scritta, va comunque interpretata.
And the winner is Vittorio Storaro, Apocalypse Now!
Well, I would make any film with Vittorio, being such a great photographer, and whatever project you approach him with, he will find something in it that will interest him and drive him.
Francis, thank you. Thank you for the trust that you gave me. Thank you for the freedom that you gave me to express completely myself in a public sense.
Vittorio is a very elegant, beautiful person, and he would always be there in the jungle in his white clothes, looking like some prince from, you know, Siena. And even when he fell from the ladder in the mud, he would get up and not be dirty. So, you know, I think Vittorio carries a style and a grace with him, just that's in his, you know, in his personality.
And the winner is Vittorio Storaro for Red.
He's simply the best in the world, in my opinion, at what he does. And sometimes it's difficult, and I just love it when he makes mistakes. There's a story I like very much because we were making Reds, and I had had the temerity to ask if a light that I saw in a factory sequence before had been was right. He called me at about 8 o'clock one night, distraught. He said that he had to talk to me. I came in, I said, Vittorio, what is it? I thought maybe something had happened to his children or his wife or some terrible thing, and he said that he had destroyed the sequence. And I said, what's the matter? And he said, I've destroyed the factory, he said. And I said, well, let's go look at it, you know. It really looked very good, you know. And I was a little upset that the mistake wasn't big enough.
And the winner is...
The winner is Vittorio Storaro for the Lair Festival.
Together we had wonderful moments, very difficult moments, and we shared a lot, and that made Vittorio kind of need for me. I need him.
Last Tempo really represents for me the result of 20 years of collaboration with Bernardo Bertolucci. A long, difficult, hard journey that was so made beautiful by a traveling guide, by a friend like Bernardo. And I really do think that into Last Tempo, there is not only one movie, but there is all ourselves. Thank you very much. Good night.
Look.
When you go to see a movie of mine, the choice of the lens, the camera movement, the relationship between the camera and the characters and the places, the space where I'm shooting, I take care of that. What I don't do, what Vittorio does, is the physical intervention of the light. The light, he paints with lights.
I don't think that each cinematographer can work with each director. I don't think that each cinematographer can do any project, any film. There is a kind of magnetic selection that you're doing while you're going. There is a kind of journey that you're doing by yourself. It's something you discover that on the same direction you can meet other people. You can meet a friend that you can do this journey. You can meet people that you can be your guide for a portion of this journey. I think Bernardo was one of those, one of the most important ones.
The Conformist was Bertolucci's and Storaro's first international success and was a highly influential film for its style, design and use of colour. Set in the 1930s, it's the story of Marcello Clerici, sent by fascists in Rome to carry out an assassination in Paris while on his honeymoon.
Before we start The Conformist, Bernardo called me. We will start to talk about The Conformist. Vittorio, I mean, what we know about that period? Mainly we know that period, the late 30s, through cinema. I remember that Bernardo saw at that moment one of the Visconti films, The Damned. And he told me, Vittorio, that can be beautiful, maybe we can do a movie like this one. And I went to see, I said, no, Bernardo, I think that photography is so great for that movie. We should come up with something very original, something very that belonged to us. The fascist time at that point in Italy was something very strong, something very difficult to go through. So the only way for me to represent that period was to drain color and go very strong in a kind of prison, in a kind of claustrophobic feeling between light and shadows, without any harmony at all.
There's one scene in The Conformist where it's the interior of Stefania Sandrelli's house, where I wanted to have to play it with stripes of light given by Venetian blinds, so that they would become the main feature of the scene. And I had conceived the room completely striped with lights. What Vittorio added to it was the movement of those stripes, which is totally surreal and not justified.
Vittorio was moving a big light on an elevating thing, platform, and was moving up. and we looked at each other on the wall. We saw this typical 40s stripes moving that, and we said, let's do it in a very excessive way. There wasn't even the consciousness of being maybe quoting expressionism or German directors in Hollywood, and it was just the pleasure of seeing that there.
From the moment that Marcello Clerici leave Rome and take a train, there's a kind of opening in the light. The light is going to go into the shadows, almost marry it, and the colors start to come out. And in the train, there is no any more realistic thing. Everything is going through fantasy. They spent 10 hours on traveling, and so we were showing it through the light change into 2-minute sequence, the 10 hours traveling. They're arriving in Paris. Paris at that moment was the land of the free way of living. You can say something that you're not able to say in your country. And at that moment, I was trying to open completely the color spectrum, open completely the light and shadows.
At the time, colors were used with more, in a more cautious way, in American movies especially, and everything was pretty and well balanced. And he had just extreme reds and blues, and you can tell he's an Italian, that he comes from the tradition of painting of people who use color, colorists. This is a very sensual scene, you see that the circle around it, or not only in lines but in movement. The great advantage we filmmakers have in relationship to painters.
Here I saw a film in which the cinematography really enforces with the director's work to do something that in many cases was extremely illogical, where the camera participated in the action almost as a character would, and it worked very beautifully.
This case was fantastic, because my English at that moment was even poor than what is to now. And Matt, I remember I never had a problem with language about Francis.
The last one is the possible, but it's not all the time. It's not exactly the same thing.
I think we're going to have to live with that, because
it's okay.
Vicaro could not speak English, and I could not speak Italian. In fact, I could speak more Italian than he could speak English. So I was dealing with an extremely intelligent, creative person. And we had no method of communication, which sometimes provides a more pure form of communication. Vittorio was trying to deal with this enormous problem of logistics and helicopters flying so high that they weren't in the front, just coming up against a lot of tasks that were beyond our ability. We, of course, personally, were continually worn down, and yet our friendship developed, and both with Vittorio and with Dean Tavallaris, the production designer. It was sort of the three of us in this together, but we did have like ambitions.
Storyboard in America without Vittorio, and then we got his ideas and put them in the storyboard. If you talk to him about an idea that you think is pretty crazy, he'll take it and say, you know, if he likes it, he'll take it and, you know, make it even more elaborate and more daring.
Thank you.
approached the helicopter sequence first for logic reason, because we were afraid not to have the helicopter for a long time. We didn't know exactly each day how many helicopters we could have, so they thought, let's do in the helicopter first, and so anything happened, at least we put on film that major sequence. After that major sequence, the movie told to us at which level we're supposed to perform. Any moment we were doing any single shot, even simple one, sometimes it's just a close-up, behind that close-up, we maybe should put some color smoke, we maybe should put some napalm explosion, we maybe supposed to put some helicopter. So any shot, in any simple sequence, it become a major issue. Apocalypse Now, for me, even at the beginning, I was not clear how and why I can be into this kind of world. Soon I read the book from Conrad. I understood the main idea was an overimposition between one culture to another culture. Right away, I translate that kind of idea between two different energy, the natural energy and artificial energy. For example, it was very easy to show the natural light that was in the Vietnam against the artificial light brought by the American. For example, the big searchlights that they were using during nights, and the light made by the explosion.
Dolong Bridge was the last army outpost on the Nung River. Beyond it, there was only Kurds.
I was trying to translate that conflict between two different nations, the two different cultures, two different civility, through a conflict of lights, lights and shadows, through a warm color and cold color, and so on. Put in conflict something that was not supposed to be in conflict. Where there is no doubt that Apocalypse Now, like Heart of Darkness, is a process of knowledge. It is a journey. And this journey is not only upriver, but it's also a journey within ourselves.
Vittorio's attitude was always, you know, well, Francis, we go step by step. You know, we just go one step, and then we look, and we do another step, and it was always that philosophy.
Willard's journey comes to an end when he encounters the private army of Kurtz, who has made his base at an old temple in the middle of the jungle. For the important role of the crazed colonel, Coppola had cast Marlon Brando.
As so many things in art, the portrayal of Kurtz is done through the nature of the materials themselves, and the fact was that Brando we had for a very little time. Brando is an extraordinary a man beyond his ability as an actor, but extremely, in a way, childlike person and mercurial and very difficult to pin down. And so we had to do what we had to do in a few weeks, and we were going to lose him. We just started almost in the dark with Brando's presence, and Vittorio began to experiment with, you know, how little could we show of him, partly because he was physically unacceptable for the role of a Green Beret colonel, and Brando is very shy about his weight and size, and so we knew that we were going to have to do this with illusion and a little sliver of light. And once Vittorio began experimenting along those lines, he himself began to create a way to approach it.
I wonder, my hair's been cut off so long, and I think that I'll be bald. I'm afraid that I'll be bald when it grows back. I don't care, except that I don't want my family to see me bald.
I want that close-up of Marlon Brando coming out from the obscurity and reveal himself step by step, point by point, ray by ray, is like coming out, something coming out from a darkness. Represent this journey into our unconscious.
And so I thought that maybe the only way is to represent the same structure of our own life with the structure of the light itself. So the journey into ourself the Wheeler is doing is the journey that could do within the color spectrum, starting from the beginning to end, into light that represents life. So that's why, for example, we Earth of Darkness is being represented by the black. Black is the unconscious, is really where everything starts. And the first step is red, is the color of the blood. Orange is the color of the warm feeling of the family. Yellow is the consciousness. Green is the process of knowing, of knowledge. Blue is your intelligence as a human being. Indigo is your primordial power. Violet is your last stage in the human life. And the sum, all of this color, is the last one, is white, which means balance, which means equilibrium. Photography means write with light. So I was trying to write with light, and with these elements, the colors, the story itself.
After assassinating Kurtz, Willard's mission is seemingly over. But Coppola had to decide whether to end the film simply with Willard's departure, or to have him call in Strategic Air Command and then show the destruction of the temple.
The original idea was blowing up all the temple. And we shot the blowing of the temple. Probably the most incredible scene ever done. We shot with several cameras in Vista Vision, in high speed, in infrared. It's one of the most fantastic visual images I've ever done in my own life. In the editing process, Francis thought that maybe he doesn't need anymore to blow up the temple, because that was not part of the main concept. I think he was right.
Apocalypse Now was really a closing chapter. I stopped for 1 year. I didn't shoot for 1 year. And I went through a long research into the only possible thing that I knew at that moment, light. What is representing light? What is forming light? Colors. One from the art was the continuous the journey into this bath of color.
I bought a movie studio, and some writer sent me a little love story called One from the Heart, and I thought, well, we'll just make that real quickly, and we'll make it in an experimental way, and basically trying to make a film more in a soundstage situation, using illusion and effects and theatrical tricks to express what was going on instead of real location.
Set in a studio recreation of Las Vegas, Coppola's simple love story concerned the relationship between a disenchanted couple, Hank and Franny. The spirit of experimentation gave Storaro the opportunity to explore the physiology of colors.
One from the Heart is a movie about, I think, emotional state between people. People will follow the story, will fall in love with the character, but I think that choosing the right direction of light and color can help tell the story, which kind of character she is, which kind of character he is, and so on. Specific, the character of Hank and Franny. Hank, to me, is green. Like Franny is red. That's maybe is an unrealistic way to see the characters, but this is kind of sensation they have from them. In the way that the main conflict starts between them. That she need activity. She needs to have a wonderful weekend and go out and do something. I need a rest. There's the conflict between two colors.
she need to be in red, he need to be in green. There is no questions about.
Hank, are you crying?
No, I don't cry.
Well, good.
If I could sing, I'd sing. I can't sing, Franny.
That's it.
This is just something that should work really underneath, something very subtle into there.
Well, that you...
Not this one, you see. There is something very, very innocent at the beginning that we can come
that
out.
One?
And if you're doing the short hairs, yeah. I don't think they should be black.
No?
Should be darker, but still brown. Warm color.
Little boy blue, come blow your horn. The dish run away with a spoon. Home again, home. Again, it's Saturday morn, and never gets up before noon. She used to render you legal and tender when you used to send her your promises, boy. A dollar, a dollar, unbutton your collar and come out and holler out all of your noise.
There's so much light around in the street of Vegas. Vegas make a sort of conflict with the nature. You rebuild the daylight to neon, so the body feel to gambling, feel to play, feel to live, don't want to rest, don't want to go to sleep.
Vittorio, like all of us, is totally nuts and is in his own universe and very much, you know, in a way as I am. And he became intrigued with the theater techniques that I was sharing with him. And I told Vittorio about this kind of lighting board, which I was very experienced in myself from my theater days. And I think Vittorio became very excited about the possibility of using these techniques, which were common in theater, but apply them with film in a way to be able to manipulate color and light in a much more adept way than film allowed. So we went out and bought some $300,000 lighting board and set it up in our own studio, which enabled us to do all these experiments.
Spostiamo, dico, non ti preoccupare. Ish, can you read me up there?
Victorio.
Can you go up to the jump on your right side? They have another one. They have another one. The system that he always uses, he's been using actually for about 8 years,
with dimmers. He puts every light on a dimmer, and he's come up with the jumbo light, which is 16 airplane landing lights. And in this particular movie, we're using to give the street a different wash of color. All we need to do is set them, and then we can turn them off and on just by, you know, getting on and talking to control, which does save, it saves a lot of energy and saves a lot of time.
Turn on your left and follow me. Keep going, keep going, keep going, keep going, keep going, all the way down, all the way down. You should be arriving right here. Fabio, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Can I see 80? 80. Okay, 85. Okay, you want to go 85?
Okay. Abbiamo fatto una pianta del set con tutte le disposizioni delle luci e numerandole. E questo permette, dopo una preparazione, una facilità estrema nell'illuminare.
Fabio, I need also the two jumbo on top of the police station, which are 70 and 71, please. Start to warm up. Over.
I'm gonna love you like nothing you've known. I'm gonna love you.
When you begin working with Vittorio on a picture, it's like getting into a huge vegetable soup, and you really come up with vegetables that you didn't know existed. And you mix it, and you mix it, and it usually tastes pretty good.
And this time I'm not only getting, I'm holding my...
I was first interested really in just primary colors, and just as I thought that the picture itself dealt with primary emotions, very simple and direct, that gets more complicated.
You know, it's legal for me to take you down to the station and sweat it out of you under the lights.
I sweat a lot better in the dark. I know how you feel. You don't know if you want to hit me or kiss me. I get a lot of that.
Look, you're safe. Big boy's in jail. You're the one that can keep him there. Give me a call.
I read the movie as an impossible love story between Breathless and the Crazy. And I present this idea to Warren, connected with where Chester Gould really had the idea to draw images like that. And I think they came from the German Expressionist. And everybody, I think, had the inspiration from this painter. And Chester Gould had the same thing, I think. So my idea was to try to bring this conflict, this dramaturgy of color, let's say, using the drama not only between light and shadow, but between the warm color, the color of the daytime, the color that belonged to one section of the color spectrum, red, the kid, orange, Tess, yellow, the crazy, representing the sun, representing the one illuminating the darkness, and all blue, indigo, violet, who is belonging to our unconscious, what we call the evil. I think the conflict between these two worlds was the main theme of the crazy.
Hai mai avuto un'età verde? È quasi impossibile, credo, non passare per il verde. Il verde credo che sia il collegamento tra la nostra innocenza e la nostra consapevolezza. Non possiamo non averlo. Il rosso è il colore dell'io, della coscienza, della natura stessa. È credo il simbolo più grande dell'energia vitale. Blu come colore... non a caso del pensiero, dell'intuizione, della introspezione, di tutto ciò che riguarda una parte interna di noi.
Vittorio writes down what he thinks
colors are going to do to the audience, emotionally. We all know what Goethe did and Newton did and all the writing that has been done about the fact that colors do affect people unconsciously. But his colors, he has his reasons to say yellow is this and red is that and blue is this and orange is that. Truth of it is we all have reasons. And very often they're quite different reasons.
The way I see it, and Plato agrees with me, is that there is what is, and then there is what we would like it to be. But that's not important. What's important is the future. It's planning ahead. A man without a plan is not a man. Nietzsche.
I start to put together, sequence by sequence, on the script itself, each given idea, so can the wall can tell exactly what I would like to say. After I've done all this journey within my mind and try to translate in words, physically word, next to the script, next to the scene itself, only at that moment I can really start filming.
Bertolucci's The Sheltering Sky, based on the novel by Paul Bowles, is the tragic story of Kit and Port, an American couple whose disintegrating marriage is strained by their journey through Morocco, ending with his death and her mental collapse. For Storaro, their individual destinies related to the journeys of the sun and the moon, and the extreme colours of the desert landscape and the sky. However, away from the studio on location, the cinematographer has to face challenges of a different kind.
He always shoot. I rarely have met the director of photography who always shoot, because the pleasure of shooting is stronger of the fact that suddenly when you are in the full sun, a cloud comes, the light changes. The other cameraman said, stop, we wait for the... No, he goes on, because anyway the light will work. And it starts to rain. We go on.
Originally, we were supposed to do a dawn sequence, waiting for the sun rising in this terrace, and there is Mrs. Lyle waiting to photograph the sunrise, and a port is right there just facing this moment. We had such bad weather that day, it was so cold, that practically we changed completely the mood of the scene in the way that was around, but the sunrise, I was able to recreate it myself. In this case, the difficult weather was helping me, because on do it by myself, I can control much better the sunrise.
We're off to Iron Crawford tomorrow. Pop it. Apparently there's a fairly decent hotel there. Not as grand as this one, of course.
Grand?
My dear Mr. Morrisby, this is positively luxurious. They say it's the best hotel from here to the Congo. From now on, there's nothing with running water. Nothing at all.
Port, durante il percorso della storia, sembra sempre più prendere coscienza con il sole, con l'immagine di se stesso, con l'identificazione del suo simbolo. Sul terrazzo di Bussife lo aspetta al mattino, lo guarda in faccia, per guardarsi in faccia, nel senso che sa che, forse, un'intima consapevolezza interna a se stesso, il percorso dello stesso astro è il percorso della sua vita.
Thank you.
sole nel suo correre nei cieli, dall'aurora del suo concepimento, all'alba della sua nascita, al mattino della sua crescita, alla consapevolezza del suo giorno, alla maturità del suo pomeriggio, ci giunge, arriva al tramonto della sua vecchiaia. In identificazione con lui, Port, arrivato ad inseguire il suo sogno verso il deserto in questo forte, arriva forse al termine del suo viaggio.
Please don't go. Please don't go, please. Please.
Kit, proprio mentre il sole tramonta, Port muore, sugli spalti di questo forte si perde davanti a questo incredibile azzurro del cielo, un azzurro che fino ad oggi ancora non conosceva. Non conosceva perché era anche lei vissuta di sole. Il desiderio, l'alternativa è una sola: seguire il sogno di Port. Proprio come la luna nel cielo, che segue l'arco del sole, che si illumina di sole, lei stessa, quasi in simbiosi con la luna questa volta, quindi una porzione, un atto, una parte, un film lunare. Un'altra porzione del colore dello spettro cromatico, l'azzurro.
Quello che mi succedeva una volta era, per esempio, temere l'azzurro. Temevo, mi sembrava non sufficientemente artistico, come si suol dire, e facevo il grande errore di annullarlo. Mi ponevo dei gialli o degli arancioni su dei blu, tentando di annullare una lunghezza d'onda, tentando di annullare una parte di me stesso, che era la parte inconscia di me. Quando ho capito questo, ho tentato di intensificare questo tipo di idea, particolarmente in questo caso con Shelter in Sky, con Port e Kit. Per cui, se Port mi rappresenta il sole, la terra, il deserto, ho tentato di intensificare la sua radice, la sua idea, quello che è il suo significato, e non annullarlo. Così con Kit, nell'ultima parte della parte del film lunare, ho tentato di intensificare il colore del cielo. Ora, ovviamente, come tutte le cose, se una parte rappresenta la terra, il sole, la materia, e l'altra rappresenta la luna, l'aria, e un po' anche l'inconscio di noi stessi, la parte, il lato femminile di noi stessi contro il lato maschile, credo che, come sempre, l'unione tra i due sia il giusto equilibrio, sia la giusta forma, sia la giusta cosa da raggiungere. Per cui la terra avrà il suo colore e il cielo avrà il suo colore, intensificato per raccontare una storia.
Abbiamo ieri fantastico, era il luccichio del web.
Beh, noi lo guardavamo nella luce del tramonto, però nell'azzurro è comunque diverso.
No, certo,
cioè, la cosa del tramonto chiaramente avevamo il brillio del controluce del fiume.
Potremmo partire dal tramonto? No, lei esce, c'è già la luna.
Ci ho pensato tutta stanotte, guarda. Perché noi avevamo la cosa lì sopra già con la luna, in cui avremo questa morire del sole e nascere della luna, che è un momento proprio particolarmente suo come donna.
At a certain moment, it was the beginning of our relationship, I understood that like some artist need for its inspiration to have a bottle of Beaujolais or to have a huge joint of grass or to have any kind of stimulating factor. Vittorio needs this kind of his own elaboration of the film. If you take away from him the freedom of doing this elaboration, he loses his inspiration. So I respect that, even if I don't agree all the time. Yes, he was thinking the blue and the red, the blue of the night and of the kind of lunar feeling of the woman and the red, which is the active of the male, of the man, etc. You know, sometimes I think the opposite. I think the man is blue and passive, and the woman is red and active. So, but he needs it. Let's him have it.
Immaginiamo degli uomini dentro una caverna, alcune centinaia di migliaia di anni fa, il fuoco alle loro spalle, loro che osservavano il fondo della caverna, degli oggetti e delle persone che si muovevano, in realtà davano un'immagine della realtà, ma non la realtà, il simulacro. Forse il primordio del cinema. Noi oggi, autori della fotografia, tentiamo di proseguire il mito di Platone stesso. Tentiamo di portare avanti in una sala scenografica che non è altro che la stessa caverna, tramite queste ombre, che andiamo a creare nello squarciare di luce la notte, per poter esprimere in immagine un certo concetto.
In 1983, Storaro photographed this short film using the new technology of high-definition videotape. The most sophisticated electronic format yet developed, it has already advanced further than this early experiment. Storaro plans to use high-definition cameras in the future on a feature film project with Francis Coppola.
Vittorio, being one of the few collaborators that I've had who really can grasp a new idea, he, rather than to cling to a notion that, no, the photographic image had to be a photochemical process, he saw that, you know, after all, video is extremely young in terms of its development, and one day it would be capable of producing the kind of image that film could now produce. He saw that.
Of course, any new step, any new evolution in technology, usually in any art form, give for the first moment a kind of stop to understand that you have to change the gear completely. High definition will do the same thing. There is no doubt that this is the future. The information that you have from an electronic point of view, you have such more freedom to express yourself than you have from an optical image. Even if the optical image up to now is still better. But this is just the beginning. Without moving from film to tape, without this will, probably human being will stay still into the cave, engraving a graffiti. So I think this is part of the need to travel, to go and to discover. It doesn't matter how long it takes. This is called evolution.
Imago Urbis is a series of documentaries on the civilization of ancient Rome. This section has been filmed on a model of the Eternal City, enabling Storaro to control his lighting with total precision.
cinema è stato un pochino legato a questo tipo di necessità dell'uso della luce naturale. I primi teatri erano non altro che dei grandi capannoni in cui il sole entrava da dei grandi vetrate luminose, schermate con dei veli, in cui la materia, la luce naturale, veniva riflessa, schermata, aggiunta, sottratta. Con la luce artificiale è un pochino scoperto ancora più la fantasia, cioè la possibilità di poter mettere ovunque, in qualsiasi posto, la luce. Come in questo caso, noi guardiamo questo plastico, ha un certo tipo di atmosfera e possiamo cambiarlo completamente. Fabio, mi cambi dal rosso al bianco, per piacere. E tutto può cambiarsi soltanto con un comando. Nel cinema, una certa corrente pittorica, l'espressionismo, ha proprio cambiato un certo modo di vedere. È cominciato proprio negli anni 30 all'uso della luce in forma espressiva. Quindi l'uso quasi come scultura, come scenografia della luce e dell'ombra. E qui abbiamo un elemento fondamentale che è Greg Toland. Greg Toland in Quarto potere di Orson Welles ha, credo, preso questa scuola pittorica e nella luce ne ha fatto espressione cinematografica. Ancora una volta ci si fermò quasi nell'espressione dell'evoluzione della fotografia cinematografica. Fino a che due grandi personaggi, pur operando in quello che era la materia che conoscevano maggiormente, il bianco e il nero, Roll Cutare in Francia e maggiormente Gianni di Venanzio in Italia, fecero una grande rivoluzione. Presero tutti i grandi proiettori che erano sopra in genere su ogni scena e li tirarono via di colpo. Nel colore ci fu un'ulteriore necessità, la necessità di collegarsi con la pittura, e questo forse Aldo Graziati, Aldo fu la persona, il personaggio che tentò maggiormente questo tipo di matrimonio tra una cultura antica che ci appartiene da sempre, sino a quella che era l'espressione in quel momento del cinema degli anni 60. Nel tempo la mia generazione ha tentato questa integrazione, questa grande mobilità luce e ombra del bianco e nero anche nel colore, e quindi tutti gli anni 70 hanno significato questa possibile espressione non più di timore ma quasi di conoscenza, cioè bisogna attingersi degli stessi colori di cui si ha timore per poterne veramente affrontarli e portarli alla coscienza. Ha portato questo tipo di evoluzione maggiore nel tempo, credo, fino alla fotografia degli anni 90 oggi.
Buongiorno, con la luce bianca, alza, 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 alza. Adesso scendi col sole e
vai. There is no doubt that the photographic vision that was able to reach until now was because I have the possibility to meet a different wave of expression, to know different people that helped me to grow up. Because I do really believe that there is no one single man, no one single culture that can grow up in a balanced way by itself. We all grow up together. During my journey, after my first part, from darkness to light, after the second part, into the light itself, within the color stage of my life, from red to orange to yellow to green to blue to indigo to violet, the third part, the research for balance between different elements, seems to me they need a different and a personal, a more intimate journey within myself. Roma Imago Urbis, this multimedia project about the ancient history of Rome, is giving me the possibility to do a summary of my own life expression, to better understand from which light I come from, to which color I am, towards which element I'm going to. A personal journey from my past to present, towards my future.
Adesso scendi col sole e vai sull'arancio, scendi col sole e vai sull'arancio, cambia tutto, cambia, cambia, vai sul tramonto, anche rosso, continua a cambiare sul rosso, scendi tutte le luci arancio là e sali con queste rosse, sali con queste rosse, dammi adesso un po' di controluce della luna che sale, quello bianco, poco poco che sale, scendi giù con il tramonto, scendi col tramonto, sali col controluce, sali, 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 adesso scendi, sali su con le stelle prima, sali con le stelle e scendi col controluce bianco, scendi tutto col controluce bianco, rimane solo il cielo stellato, su tutto il firmamento. Lascia così, risorgi con l'alba piano piano, lasciando le stelle accese, piano piano con la luce diffusa in controluce. Vieni su piano piano, molto lentamente, piano piano, vai, 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 continua, 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 continua. Benissimo, scendi con le stelle adesso, scendi Fabio, scendi giù con le stelle, sali con l'arancia di nuovo, sali con l'arancia di nuovo, più verso il tramonto adesso, vai su con l'arancia, Adesso scendi con l'arancio e sali di nuovo con il rosso. Rifallo di nuovo, forza, fammelo vedere. Un pochino più stretto. Adesso sali subito con le stelle, senza passare nel bianco. Sali con tutte le stelle, sali con le stelle e scendi con il rosso. Vai tutto il rosso giù, tutto il rosso. Sali con le stelle prima, vai su, scendi con il rosso, su, giù a terra. Fermo. Grazie.